gathering here is depleted a bit. One fella couldn't be here because of some illness, but he said his buddy would be here, but his buddy didn't show up either, so. But that's all right. You're here to sing tonight. There's a scripture, Psalm 149, praise the Lord, sing to the Lord a new song, his praise in the assembly of the saints. Well, I'm going to lead you in a song that to some people is a new song. Linda didn't even know it, but it's old. It's entitled, Come Christians, Join to Sing. That's what Psalm 149 said. It said, let's sing to the Lord a new song. Well, if this is a new song to you, it's not a very difficult one, but it's kind of a stand up and tap your foot kind of song. So why don't you stand with me, okay? And then we're going to sing this and a couple of others, and then we're going to concentrate on a few beautiful songs and choruses about our Lord Jesus. I think Pastor Gordon is going to take us further into Philippians, where it talks about Jesus and his name lifted high, and every knee shall bow at the name of Jesus. So we're going to sing about that a little bit like later. Let's sing this.
Stop.
everybody said?
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Jesus. Let's just say those words, Jesus. What a wonder. What a wonder you are. You are so gentle.
Oh, Gotta get all dressed, you know. Well, good to see all of you tonight. Are you glad to be in the house of the Lord? Wow. That was a great singing tonight. I love those songs about Jesus, don't you?
Yes.
Just kind of get lost in His presence. Good place to get lost, huh?
Yeah.
For you to get lost in His presence. Wow. I was thinking as we were singing some of those songs, you know, we get into His presence by faith, which is a wonderful thing, right? But one day we're going to get into His presence by sight. And in case you haven't heard, two of our members have talked to me with Jesus the last couple of days. And first off, Bob Cormack, Alina's beloved husband. Good to have you here tonight. And I don't know if you know, but her daughter, Cheryl, used to go to our church when we were pastoring in Dawson Creek 20 years ago. So we got to reconnect yesterday, and her husband was here and her two kids. I should call them two kids anymore because they're all grown up now. But yeah, we got to connect, so that was a wonderful time. And then this morning, Lauren Hosenton, I think I'm saying that right, he passed into the presence of the Lord. And of course, you remember Edith and Ruby and Lauren, always sat right over there. And this morning, he went to be with Jesus. Wow. You know, there's something, you know, because we are believers in Jesus, it's an exciting thing to think about how a person is on earth one moment and in His presence the next. It's amazing, right? I don't know about you, but I've been at the bedside of people that have passed on a number of times, and I just kind of, my imagination just kind of pictures angels surrounding that loved one and escorting them to the presence of the Lord. And then you think, when they get into the presence of the Lord, what must that be like? I mean, how do you even imagine that? I mean, just singing those songs tonight, I mean, we were into the presence of the Lord, but it was all by faith. You know, you can feel His presence and sense His presence, but it's not the same as being in His presence. Wow. So Bob and Lauren, they are no more sickness, no more disease. They got perfect sight, no more walkers. Isn't that wonderful? I mean, come on, folks, we got a great hope. Praise the Lord. So excited. And so anyway, we do want to pray for them. We know that even though they have that wonderful hope, there's still the emptiness. And so tonight we just want to lift up the Cormack family and the Hosington. Am I saying that right? Hosington family. Let's pray for them. So Father, we're so thankful tonight that they knew Jesus, these two men. And we're so thankful tonight, Lord, that be absent from this body is to be present with You.
Yes.
And Lord, we believe that here tonight. We don't believe that that's just the end, but we believe it's just the beginning.
Yes.
Lord, that we're in the land of the dying. They're in the land of the living.
Yes.
And so we celebrate that tonight, Lord. We celebrate that they're with You, Lord, that they have been set free, Lord, from the shackles of this earth. They don't have to worry about COVID, mask, or passports, or anything else. Lord, they're with You. And we are so thankful, Lord, for that assurance that we have. But Lord, tonight they leave behind some precious wives and families. And we pray tonight, Lord, that You will just surround these families. Lord, we pray for Your comfort. Thank You, Lord, that You've given us the Holy Spirit. And so, God of all comfort, just comfort them tonight, their family, Lord, their extended family. Wrap Your arms around them, Lord. May they just know of Your presence. And Lord, may they just have that assurance in their hearts that, Lord, that they are with You tonight. And they are in a wonderful place. Lord, we sing that old hymn, Heaven is a wonderful place. And it is a wonderful place. And Lord, one day we're all going to be there. What a great day that will be. Thank You, Lord. So bless them tonight, Lord. We also think of Alvin Lord, who's traveling to be at his sister's funeral. Lord, we pray you would be with him and Marilyn and their family as well, Lord. And others, Lord, we can think of Olive, Lord, as she mourns the loss of her husband. Julia, Lord, there's so many. Rosemary, Lord, we just pray for your comfort to be with all of these. Lord, have lost someone very important and special to them. Comfort them, we pray. And we thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, next Wednesday, as you know, the last Wednesday of the month is prayer summit right here. And so there's no normal legacy builder, but I would encourage you to come to prayer summit. Linda and I went to the first one here. We really enjoyed it. That was an awesome sense of God's presence. So that's next Wednesday at 6:30. And I want to throw something out to you. I've been, you know, doing some visiting with people, and there are some who can't get out, you know, because of health issues, because they're not able to. And so we're trying to come up with something. I've been talking to some of our guys in the last couple of days. We're trying to come up with a way that we could bring the service to them, either by a CD or by a DVD. And a lot of these people that I'm talking about, they don't have access to Wi-Fi. So we're trying to come up with something, you know, whether we can have a portable something. So if you know somebody that is shut in, they don't have any access to Wi-Fi or DVDs or, you know, DVD player, could you let me know, or Linda know, or Debbie back there, could you let one of us know? And we're going to see what we can do to, so that they can. I talked to somebody, actually it was Alvina Martin, who had surgery on Monday, and we saw her yesterday, she's doing good. But she said, you know, she looks out from Gordon Place there, and she sees all of you coming here, and she's almost crying because she can't come. You know, she's not in, of course, with her hip. Hopefully that she'll be able to walk again and come, because she really wants to come. But there's people like her. So if we can think of some names, and maybe you know some people, we want to see what we can do to bring the church service to them. Is that something good idea? Amen. All right. So if you can think of somebody, just let us know. And again, I want to thank Dan and his team. These guys are here early and practicing. What a great job they all do. Yes. And we have our beautiful camera lady back there, and Debbie back there, and Dawn and Jerry somewhere around floating there. So we thank them. And also Marlene and Marilyn, and back at the doors. Thank you all for all you do. Without you, we couldn't do what we do. Amen?
Amen.
So tonight, we are talking about leading from Jesus' example. And Philippians chapter 2, beginning at verse 5, down to verse 11. And you remember on that back table, I have a thing that Chuck Swindoll did a number of years ago called Attitude. If you haven't picked one up, pick one up. It's a good thing to remind yourself about an attitude. How many know sometimes we need an attitude adjustment? Now let's all put our hands up because we're all in the same boat. We all need attitude adjustments, right? Sometimes we wake up on the wrong side of the bed. And we need to get back in bed and get on the right side, right? Because sometimes we do need an attitude adjustment. I mean, it's easy to lose our attitude. I was going home today, or this afternoon, most of you know, we live real close to the church, so I walk back and forth all the time. And so at noon, I was walking home, and here was a guy speeding down the Gord. I mean, he had me doing like 100 kilometers. And I'm thinking, you know, man, what is this guy doing? And I wish I, you know, it was a police at that point. You know, I wish I could do something, right? I mean, I wanted to get my camera out, take a picture of the license plate. I mean, you know, I was getting frustrated. I was thinking, you know, my wife was talking about the ESL. You know, they're just getting out at that time. And of course, the school, some of the parents are coming out there. And I was thinking, this guy, you know, man. And I had to adjust my attitude. Yeah, I was doing a little bit of grumbling on my walking home. So before I got to the house, my attitude got adjusted, I think, a little bit, you know. My wife did some fine tuning. That's one of the things about being married, and we can adjust it, and our wife does fine tuning. All right, so let's talk about Philippians chapter 2, verse 5 to verse 11. Your attitude, this is out of the New International Version, your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man. He humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Wow, that's a beautiful passage, isn't it? You know, we've been talking about the overall theme of Philippians is about living the Christian life. And if we're going to live this Christian life, you know, part of it has to do with our attitude, right? Attitude and Christian living go hand in hand. And so Paul really challenges us with attitude. And if you wives, you know, your husband's having a bad day with his attitude, just encourage him to read Philippians chapter 2. And see if it doesn't help his attitude. I know you women never have an attitude difficulty, so. But for us guys, you know, I mean, we get cut off, you know, as we're driving. There's all kinds of things that can upset us. And so, we need to have this attitude adjustment. So living the Christian life and attitude go really hand in hand. To be a Christian should include having a good attitude, don't you think? There's nothing worse than a Christian with a bad attitude. Nothing worse than that. I mean, to be, we are to be Jesus with skin on. And I talked about that last week, that we are the fifth gospel. There's Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and then there's you and me. We are the light. We are the salt. And if people are going to know Jesus, a lot of it is because of our reflection. And I mentioned this last week, how many times have we heard people say, you know, I don't want nothing to do with the church. And often it's because of some Christian that maybe said something or did something and it turned them off. As a pastor, I've seen this over and over again. And I'm not making excuses for it, but as a Christian, we need to have a good attitude. And you know, we have plenty of help because you and I have got the Holy Spirit. And when we have the Holy Spirit, there's the fruit of the Spirit. And you know this verse out of Galatians chapter 5, verse 22, 23. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such there is no law. So tonight I'd like us to consider some things that we can learn from Jesus' example. I have five things for us to look at tonight. Five things. First off, number one, if you're taking notes, Jesus had a great attitude. He had a great attitude. And Paul begins here in Philippians chapter 2, verse 5, talking about the attitude of Jesus. In the NIV, I read this already. Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus. The New Century Version says, in your lives, you must think and act like Jesus Christ. Wow. The King James Version, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. That's pretty clear, isn't it? It's pretty clear from the word. So the word mind and attitude mean to think or direct one's mind to a thing to seek or strive for. So over the years, as I've studied the life of the Apostle Paul, I see a person who worked on having a attitude like Jesus. Now, in the book of Philippians, you know, Paul's attitude comes across very clear. As we get into the next two chapters, you know, chapter 3, chapter 4, we'll see how, you know, we'll continue to see how his attitude comes across. I mean, he's telling the church to rejoice even as he's in prison. Talk about a good attitude. Rejoice. That's what he tells us, remember? Rejoice in the Lord always. We should have sang that chorus. And again, I say rejoice. Rejoice. Like I said last week, he wasn't on a Caribbean cruise on the balcony. He was sitting in a prison. And yet he is telling us to rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always. Isn't that a great goal to have in life? You know, sometimes seniors, we get the rap of being grumpy. But we don't want that rap, do we? You're on camera, so let's be loud. We don't want anyone who's grumpy, do we? No, let's shout that out. We want to have joy. I don't know about you, but I want to live my life with joy. Now, I know sometimes we've got reasons to complain because we have aches and pains, you know. Our bodies are not the same anymore. They don't do what they should do. You know, they don't act like they should act. Our bodies, we are getting older, right? We are getting older. We don't have the same strength. Up here we do. You know, we still feel young, but here it's a different story, you know. And you know, we wake up and so sometimes we have reasons to be grumpy. Oh, so we have to work at having joy. Again, I mentioned I had a wonderful mom who really was a great example for me. I mean, I was blessed that way. And I know I was very blessed to have a mom that it didn't matter what life brought her way, she was able to find joy. In fact, when I'd go visit her, you know, we're living in Dawson Creek and she was living in Coquitlam. And so every time I came down, which is maybe twice or three times a year, and I always took my mom out for, you know, a meal and spent time with her. And so she never wanted to sit in the front seat. She always wanted Linda to be in the front seat as I was driving. And so my mom would be sitting in the back seat. And, you know, my mom didn't have a great voice, yeah, but, you know, she just loved to sing. And they said, well, you know, God made the crows too, right? And so my mom would be sitting in the back seat and she would just be singing away. Just, you know, smiling away, just worshiping the Lord. I mean, that she just had joy. Did things go always right in her life? No, she lost her husband and was by herself for over 15 years. She had, you know, pains and stuff, and lack of friends, she got moved around, and so there was a lot of things to complain about. She always found joy, though. And I remember after my dad passed away, they were living in Abbotsford at that time. My mom didn't want to stay in that condo anymore. She wanted to move to Coquitlam and be closer to my sisters. And so we were trying to look for places with my mom. And we were looking at different little, you know, places where she could live, you know, and stuff. And we came to, I mean, it was hardly anything at that time. And we came to this one place, I could tell you, it looked pretty ugly. And my mom went in there and she was saying, oh, this is so nice. And we're looking at her, hello? This is nice? Yes, this is nice. Oh, look at the view. I mean, she was able to find the good. And you can ask my wife, I'm not exaggerating. And we said, you're not going to stay in this. God's got something better for you. And he did. Praise the Lord. But she was able to find joy in her circumstances. And I often said, I want to be like that. I want to find joy in my circumstances. It doesn't matter what happened. I want to, what my son used to say, go to joy. You can go to joy. How many know you can go to joy? You can go to joy. You can wake up today, or, you know, tomorrow, and you can go to joy. You don't have to wake up grumpy. You can go to joy. Because the joy of the Lord... I didn't hear you. Remember, we're on camera. The joy of the Lord is your strength. I don't read anywhere in the Bible that says the grumbling is your strength. The joy of the Lord is your strength. And so, what a great thing. You know, the life of Jesus wasn't easy. I mean, how many know that Jesus had all kinds of things? Challenges. I mean, he knew rejection. He knew betrayal. He knew loneliness. He knew pain. He knew sorrow. And yet he had this great attitude. It says in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15, this high priest of ours understands our weakness, for he faced all the same testings we do, yet he did not sin. So Paul was writing this letter from jail to the church at Philippi, who were dealing with some great challenges themselves. So, you know, sometimes we often excuse bad attitude because of life's circumstances. We sometimes do that. If things were better, you know, I would be more happy, more joyful. But Paul is saying here that no matter what our circumstances, we can rejoice. We can rejoice. What a great attitude to have. In fact, James 1:2 says, "Dear brothers and sisters, when trouble comes your way, consider it an opportunity for what? For great joy." I'm still working on that one. When troubles come your way, consider it an opportunity for great joy. And then the next few verses of our text, Paul talks about the attitude of Jesus. So as we continue looking at this attitude, the second thing we see is set aside self-will. Again, in Philippians chapter 2, verse 4, we mentioned that last week, Paul said, each of you should look not only to your own interest, but also to the interest of others. That's what Jesus did. Even though he was equal with God, he did not consider equality with God something to be grasped. To accomplish the work of redemption, Jesus had to set aside his interest. And for the sake of us, he said, "Father, if there be any other way, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not my will, not my interest, but your will be done." Aren't you glad he did that? We would be here tonight if Jesus hadn't done that. I'm so glad he put aside his interest for the sake of the cross. You know, Frank Sinatra sang this song. Probably Dan Duke is probably singing it too. Except it wouldn't be your song, but he said, "I did it my way." If Dan was to sing the song, he would say, "I did it his way." Because Jesus did it his way. He didn't do it my way, he did it the Father's way, right? Jesus set aside his will to accomplish the will of his Father. And we are so thankful he did. In our human nature, we become very positional conscious. There are things we don't like to do because we see them as being beneath us. Now, the disciples are a good example of that. You remember the story in John chapter 13? They were all there in the upper room, and Passover was happening, and all the disciples sat down with dirty feet, you know. And in June, I actually spoke about that in the series that Pastor Will was doing at that time. I talked about servanthood and how that Jesus, had all these disciples, and none of them got up to grab the towel in the wash basin. They were sitting there by the side of the door. The door made up was a job for a slave. They were in a borrowed room, so there was no slaves. And so they all sat around the table with dirty feet, very uncomfortable. I always wear socks and shoes, so I don't know what that's like. But my wife, she goes around with bare feet and stuff, and so once in a while, in the summertime. And so she'll wash her feet before she goes to bed at night, and just make it more comfortable. And so you can imagine these disciples, how uncomfortable it was, but nobody wanted to get up to pick up the towel in the basin because it was beneath them. I mean, they were all looking for position. The question they were asking is, who's going to sit on the right and who's going to sit on the left? Who's going to be the greatest in the kingdom? I mean, they were all looking for these positions. And so the story, Jesus gets up and he washes all of their feet. This is an amazing story. Because we call him Master, we call him the Lord, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, and here he is going around washing all of their dirty feet. It's an amazing picture, and he shocked them when he did that. It wasn't a struggle for Jesus to pick up a towel in the basin. It wasn't a struggle. I mean, the disciples were sitting there struggling to think, who's going to do that? John's a young guy, he should do that. This guy was the last on call, he should do it. They probably were pointing fingers at one another, Or wish we had a slave. And here Jesus gets up. But Jesus didn't have to process that. It came naturally to him to pick up that towel and basin. Wow. So he put aside self-will, set aside self-will. The third thing is, we see is the nature of a servant. The reason that Jesus could set aside self-will is because he had the very nature of a servant. Now, most important people, those with higher rank, they're looking at their position. They're climbing up the ladder. This is kind of the way it works in earthly kingdom, when you kind of go up the ladder. Well, in the kingdom of God, it's the very opposite. If you want to be great in his kingdom, you must what? We don't know the Bible here? If we want to be great in his kingdom, we must be the servant of all, right? It's the opposite. If you want to be great in the earthly kingdom, you've got to keep climbing that ladder. You've got to get to the top. Even if you've got to push some other people away, you've got to get to the top. But if you want to be great in God's kingdom, you've got to learn to be the servant of all. Wow. Those are good conversations to have with your church staff. I used to have this conversation with my church staff. I said, if you're walking in the church and you see garbage on the floor, don't think it's beneath you to pick it up. Pick up that garbage on the floor, right? I mean, it should be natural. It should be something we should think about. Where's those custodians? No, let's pick up that garbage. Jesus, Matthew chapter 23, verse 11, Jesus said, the greatest among you will be your servant. That's what Jesus said. The greatest among you will be your servant. So when Jesus came to the earth, he took on the very nature of a servant. The very nature of the servant is to what? Is to serve. That's the nature of a servant. And when Linda and I were in Uganda, and we stayed at this Airbnb, and it was actually a Muslim lady there, but she has such a heart of a servant. I mean, she just loved to serve us, And we had, dirty shoes because the roads were dusty, so we had, of course, I have shoes and socks on. My wife, I think you had sandals on and bare feet up. But anyway, she was ready to wash our feet. I said, you're not going to wash my feet. I can do that, But she never thought about it. I mean, it was no big deal for her to. And I was thinking, she really has the heart of a servant. It was not a big effort for her to come and serve. Now, for me, it would have been a big effort. I had to do something, to say, I'm ready to wash your feet. I mean, and you're the same way, right? You're not going to admit it, huh? Don't forget, you're in church, so you've got to admit it. We're the same way. Servant-minded people can pick up a towel. And servant-minded people, that's just the way they are. They don't have to think about it. Jesus never had to take time to think about picking up that towel and that wash basin. It just came automatic because he took on the very nature of a servant. God's kingdom and the church work well when the members have a servant heart. And I'm so thankful for this church because there's so many of you that have the heart of a servant, and I see it. Whether it's here or in church on Sunday or during the week, you're involved in ministry, you're doing things. And I applaud you for that, having the heart of a servant. But you think everybody in the church ought to have a heart of a servant? We ought to have a heart of a servant. God's kingdom flourishes when we come with a heart of a servant. And so one of the things that when we come into the church, in fact, Pastor Mike, they had that that class a couple weeks ago, newcomers class, and they talked about the five steps, getting tied in. And one of the steps was that I'm here to serve. We're here to serve. Don't you think all of us should have that mindset? I am here to serve. This is not a country club. Did anybody recognize that this is not a country club? It's not a country club. This is the kingdom. This is the church. And in the church, we're servants. And we're all on the same level. And the one that's the greatest amongst us is the servant of all. Kind of upside down, isn't it? God doesn't think it's upside down. So Jesus said, just as the Son of Man, in Matthew 20, 28, just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve. He gave us such a great example. I'm not here to be served, but to serve. And then the fourth thing, walk in humility and obedience. When you look at these things that, you know, they go hand in hand. It begins with having the attitude of Jesus, setting aside self-will, taking on the nature of a servant, and being willing to walk in humility and obedience. You know, Jesus was so unlike the religious leaders of his day. Linda and I, you know, we kind of watched that program, The Chosen. And you've seen movies about Jesus, you know, over the years. And anytime you see movies about Jesus in that time, you see all the religious leaders, you know, how they want attention, you know. And Jesus kind of challenged them, you know. They want to be seen of men. You know, when they give their tithes, you know, it's, you know, everybody see? You know, they put it in the bucket, you know. And when they do prayers, they do the long prayers, you know, to be seen, right? It's all about drawing attention to themselves. That's what it was all about with the religious leader. But when Jesus came, it was the very opposite. Don't let your right hand know what your left hand does. Do we need to be praised to do something? Or can we do it without being praised? I had this person say to me, not in this church, because this church wouldn't do that, but in another church, they said, I don't think I'm going to do this anymore because no one appreciates it. Have you ever heard that before? And I asked this person, I said, well, who are you doing it for? Are you doing it for recognition, or are you doing it for his glory and honor? Are you doing it for Jesus? Check your motives. Why do we do what we do? It needs to be for the glory of God, right? It needs to be for that. And when it gets mixed up, if you're looking for recognition, you'll get disappointed, because sometimes we're not good. I try to recognize people that are involved in helping, but sometimes I blow it, you know, I might not recognize somebody. But we're not doing it for recognition, we're doing it because and I know those who are serving that are not doing it for recognition. You know, Dan is not sitting over there, boy, I hope Pastor says something good about me tonight, you know, appreciates me. I know he's not that way. Right? Just checking. We do it because we love Jesus, right? That's why we serve the Lord. And a person with a servant's heart, you know, is just the opposite, you know, of a person that is proud. I mean, a person that has a servant's heart, there's humility, there's obedience, and they just want to do something for Jesus. So waiting on tables, washing your master's feet, I mean, you know, when you do all those things, it gets rid of pride. In the worldly context, you could be humble and obedient, but still not be like Jesus, unless it comes from the heart. It can just be lip service. For some people, it's just lip service. The Lord knows the heart, right? He knows the heart. And our desire must come from our service must come from the heart. So walking in humility and obedience must come from the heart, and the Lord sees our heart. He sees our heart. In 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 4, it says, through these he has given us his very great and precious promises, so that through them you may participate in the divine nature and escape the corruption in the world caused by evil desire. Isn't that wonderful? We get to participate in the divine nature. And my last point, number 5, let God do the exalting. My dad always used to say this. He would say, I'm not looking for human affirmation or reward. I'll wait until I get to heaven. Great attitude to have, because, you know, sometimes people don't thank you for what you do. I mean, you can do something and no one says nothing. I mean, I've had that happen many times in my life, you know, where I've done something. In fact, sometimes you do something and nobody knows you've done it. I mean, do you know who raked the leaves in the churchyard the other day? I can tell you. He's not looking for recognition. He's just doing it. He wants to do it. In fact, he's got a mask on, a hat on. Hardly even recognize who it is. And I go up to him and tell him, you know, hey, I appreciate you doing this, you know, and I have to look carefully to know who it is. He's in disguise. He has a mask. We're all in disguise these days, right? Hard to tell. You know, he's not doing it for any self-glorification. He's doing it because he just wants to serve Jesus. And I applaud him for that. It's so wonderful. You know, so I could take hours, and I won't do that, to tell you how my dad served his Lord. My dad, he made a lot of sacrifices for the kingdom. And a lot of people don't know the things that my dad did. He was bivocational. He could have been full-time pastoring, but he always worked in the sawmill and pastored the church. And one of the reasons he did that, so that they could pay the church off quicker, but they had to build a new church. So he took part of his salary, and I don't recommend this for anybody, but he took part of his salary that he should have paid, and he ended up, you know, putting on the mortgage of the church. And then when he left the church, I can brag about him because he's no longer with us. He's in heaven. But when he left the church, he sold the parsonage, his house. He sold it to the church for a very low price, like $13,000. He basically gave it away. This is 1971. He gave it away so that the church could be as close to debt-free as possible. And he never went around grumbling or complaining or advertising that. I know that because I'm his son. If I wasn't his son, I wouldn't know that. And the only reason I know it because I'm nosy and asked, how much did you get for your house, Dad? Because the house I grew up in, how much did you get for the house? And when he told me, in Campbell River, I said, what? $13,000? You had a beautiful view of the Quadra Island and the lighthouse. You had a beautiful, you know, a nice house, $13,000. He said, well, I wanted to help the church out. Well, I can tell you, folks, great is his reward in heaven. Great is his reward. And when he went through heaven, I imagine the words that were said to him, well done, thy good and faithful servant. And you know, there are so many people like my dad in this world, probably right in this church here. You know, you have served the Lord. You have given to the Lord. And I'm not just talking maybe in the last, you know, year, but in previous years, you've done something for the Lord. And maybe nobody else really knows what you've done. But there is one who's keeping record. His name is Jesus. And one day, it will be worth it all. When we see Jesus, wow. It says here, let me read you a couple of verses in Matthew chapter 6, verse 4. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. Wow. God will reward you. You know, some of our people in this church have written books and things that they have done. I mean, and the half probably hasn't been told of what they've done. But the Lord one day will reward. Aren't you glad no matter what you do, there is a reward for that if you have the right heart? I think the right heart is important. But until that day that Jesus calls us home, let us serve the Lord faithfully. Let me give you another couple of verses here. Galatians chapter 6, verse 9. Let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. I don't know how many of you know John Nygaard. I remember John Nygaard. He came to speak at the church that I pastored. He built a lot of the churches for the indigenous people on the West Coast and done a lot of sacrifices. He would fish during the summer so that he could raise money to build the church. And so he would take all that money and put it in, in the next church that he built. I remember him telling the story one time. I think it's in his book, but he was in Prince Rupert building the church there. If you've ever been in the church that John Nygaard built, you'll notice they all got skinny hallways. John Nygaard was real skinny, so he built the hallway skinny. I used to get a kick out of some of the indigenous pastors, you know, that were, you know, good size, and they had a hard time walking down the hallways. blessed man he is. But I remember him telling the story. He was at Prince Rupert and the old muskie there, and the horrible building conditions, you know, and everybody's excited that John's coming to help build the church, you know, and first day everybody shows up and they're all helping, and then it starts to pitter. You know, anybody's been a pastor in the building program, I know what that's like. You know, a lot of enthusiasm to begin with, and pretty soon it just starts to die down. And he was saying, I don't know how long he was there, after a week or 2 weeks, nobody was helping him. And he had the wheelbarrow and the shovel, and he was just slaving away, trying to build this church. And he just got so discouraged, so frustrated, he threw his shovel down, and he said, I quit. If nobody else cares, why should I care? And he sat there, you know, on the side, there just having a pity party. And the Lord came to John and says, John, who are you doing this for? And he just broke down and wept. I'm doing it for you, Jesus. Got back down and picked up that shovel, got the wheelbarrow, and he built the church. That stuck with me. I'm doing it for Jesus. That's what we should do things for it. Doing it for Jesus. Not doing it for earthly rewards, but I'm doing it for Jesus. Colossians chapter 3, verse 23 and 25. Whatever you do, well, that's pretty exhaustive. Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for men. Since you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward, it is the Lord Christ you are serving. Now, I know most of us in the prime of our, you know, our life and stuff, we've been serving Jesus for many, many years, but we're not done. There's still something we can do, right? There's still something you can do. I mean, you might be limited to what you can do, but there's still something you can do. Maybe it's just being a sweet person. How many know we need lots of sweet people in the church? You ever know what? I remember one man years ago, he came to church, and I didn't realize until afterwards, but he was at a low point in his life, and some dear old lady gave him a hug. That's all he did, just gave him a hug. But you know, it made his day, it made his week. It totally changed. I mean, I know today we got COVID restrictions and stuff, but go ahead and hug, you know. But it was, what's that? The clear call, can you cut that out? But you know, it just changed how he, you know, it just made his day. Just a simple hug. Now, you know, we can do that, right? When we can. We didn't do that. I'm trying to get out of the hole I dug myself. So we serve the Lord with a good heart, right?
Yeah.
Serve the Lord. And we're called to be like Jesus. And I know that's a high and mighty calling, to be like Jesus. We are to be holy, as loving as he is, but it doesn't stop there. We need to have that same attitude that Jesus had. I'm here to serve. Isn't that wonderful Jesus said that? I am here to serve. I think every Christian should have that mindset. I am here to serve. I am here to serve. Last verse, James 4:10, humble yourself before the Lord, and he will lift you up. So, Father, thank you for your word tonight. Thank you, Lord, for the example that you have given us. What a great example, Lord. Tonight, Lord, we just want to be like you. We want to be like you, Jesus. We want to say, I'm here to serve. Lord, I'm here to do what you called me to do. And Lord, I know many of us are getting near maybe the end of our lives, and we don't have the same energy that we once had, and maybe we can't do the things that we once could do. But Lord, there's still something we can do. Maybe it will be limited just to being a prayer warrior, praying. We can all do that. Lord, what a wonderful thing to think about people lifting up the Sunday morning service in prayer. To lift up the ecclesia service in prayer. To lift up the church, Sunday school, and kids ministry, and youth ministry. Lord, to lift all those things up in prayer. We can do that, Lord. We can do that. And so, Lord, tonight, help us to have the same attitude that Jesus had. Lord, we're not perfect, but Lord, we want to be as close as we can to being like Jesus. So, Father, I just pray a blessing over everyone that's here tonight. And again, we continue to pray, Lord, that you will comfort those, Lord, who need comfort. Lord, just be near them, we pray. And Lord, we also just pray that if anyone has a need here tonight, whatever that might be, Father, we pray for your healing power. Thank you, Lord, that Bob's daughter continues to improve. Lord, we thank you for the good report. Lord, she's getting better. And Lord, we just know, Lord, that you're touching people and you're healing people. And God, just pray that you'll continue to help each one of us, Lord, just to be the person you want us to be. So, Lord, I just pray a blessing over everyone here tonight. Bless every person, Lord. Every couple, every family. Bless them, Lord, I pray. And Lord, help us, Lord, to be Jesus with skin on to our community, to where we live, I pray, in Jesus' name.
To be like Jesus.
Help us each day that we be like Jesus. We pray in your name. Amen. God bless you. Good.